Just very brief introduction into myself and Supercell first. So basically, I've been an entrepreneur first and foremost in games for roughly 11 years now. I've been extremely lucky to be. I've always had a chance to sort of work at the forefront of a launch of new technologies or new type of game concepts or a sort of business models. And partly Supercell is also about that. Primarily, my background is on mobile and casual. And then briefly about Supercell. So we are a relatively young startup. We are headquartered in Helsinki, in Finland. We just recently opened up an office in San Francisco in the US. We are roughly 45 people. We have a strong team of like veteran developers, like from a mix of backgrounds from console and social and mobile. We are backed by some of the best people in the industry. We've raised roughly $15 million in funding from people like Axel Partners and also some well-known business angels like Dave Gardner, Phil Harrison, and Klaus Kerstin, whom I'm sure everybody from Germany would at least know as a founder of GameForge. So that's us. But then to the topic of the presentation. So I want to share a bit of the background. So why did we decide to build a product like Gunshine? So what was the kind of thinking process roughly 18 months back? And that'll probably help you to kind of understand some of the logic and also some of the learnings here. So to start with a very high level overview, we believed at that time, and we still believe as a company, that the vast majority of the time and money spent on games is kind of moving to these types of sort of mass market platforms, devices that everybody has access to. And what makes us really excited about these platforms is that they're all connected and socially connected. So be it Facebook, Apple Game Center, Twitter, whatever social network you're connected to, most people do at least one of these things. But what kind of struck us at that time, and I think still is surprising, is that if you look at the kind of the current generation of social games on these types of platforms, I think it's fair to ask a question about how social these games really are. And we kind of like asked ourselves the question that could social be about something else than just spamming your friends' Facebook walls or just, you know, sending resources back and forth? This was kind of the state of the play 18 months ago, and actually, to my surprise, still is to a large extent, on, especially on the Facebook platform. So we wanted to do something a little bit different. So before that, okay, for us, what social really means is that people play together a multiplayer game. We also wanted to kind of raise the bar in terms of production values for Facebook games. And at the same time, we really believe that we want to create this cross-platform experience. So while we were building a Facebook game, we wanted our users to also be able to play the game off Facebook without a Facebook account. And also in the future on other devices than just the web browser. So that was kind of a starting point. And that brought us to this game called Gunshine.net. And for those of you who haven't actually seen or played the game, I'm just going to run a quick trailer so you get a better idea of the game. So needless to say, a pretty different experience to your typical Facebook game, which usually has to do something with, and especially at that time, had to mostly do with city building or farming. So really what we kind of built was a sort of full-blown MMO with almost features that exactly matching those even like sort of a heavy client MMOs that were available at the time. And as I said, it's completely flash-based, but still took the kind of production values at least a couple of steps higher than what had been seen at that time from other games. So basically, in terms of the timeline, we started to develop a game in June 2010. It took us roughly 8 months to get it to closed beta, a few more months to get it to open beta, and then we actually launched it on November last year. Currently, we are tracking at roughly 300,000 monthly players in the game, both on and off Facebook. So one maybe point worth noting is that you can't follow the progress of our game, for example, just only by looking at the app data figures. As we run it, as a fair amount of our players are also just playing it on our own site, and then we work with guys like Kongregate who also run the game. So that's the game, and now we get to the part. So what do the metrics look like, and what's really working, and what isn't? And actually, like when I prepared the presentation, I spent quite a bit of time thinking that how should I present and what should I present. But then I actually got extremely lazy, and I thought that I would make life easy for myself, and I'll just take a couple of internal slides, and I'll explain how we actually think about this internally, and not worry about how much information I should share, and etc. So that's just the lazy part of me. But so basically, in Supercell, this is always how we kind of start to think about things when we launch a new game and develop a new game. We kind of try to construct a funnel that's somehow specific to that game. With Gunshine, basically, we've decided to split it to four parts. So apparently, it all starts with a tutorial and playing the solo game, player playing on his or her own. Then you get to this asynchronous part of the game. And in Gunshine, that part is about, we have this feature called hire your friend as a mercenary. It means that I can hire your character even if you're offline. And that I can actually guide that character, and by completing missions, we can both earn in-game money for both of our avatars. Then if you go one layer deeper, you have the real-time co-op multiplayer, so where you can actually, together with three other people, you can in real time fight against the boss enemies of Gunshine. And then the last level and the deepest level is the player versus player multiplayer, which is also real time. So let's take a look how do players divide between these layers. So as you can see, roughly 2/3 of the players have gotten to the asynchronous part. 1/3 have gotten to the real-time part, and roughly 10% are actually playing the deepest part of the game, which is a player versus player. One really interesting thing that we found out was that if we match this to the amount of friends, and by friends, I'm not referring to Facebook friends, I'm referring to in-game friends. In Gunshine, it's possible to friend people even if you're not a friend of them in Facebook. As you can see, the amount of friends correlates really nicely on what kind of level and how deeply engaged you are with the game. But of course, the most interesting part is the monetization, and this is how that looks like. So as every other social game company, also we measure monetization by the daily ARPU figure, so your revenue divided by the daily active users per day. And as you can see, basically, the solo game starts at only 3 cents per day, which is definitely below the average for any like good or successful Facebook game. But then it actually increases very rapidly as you kind of go to deeper levels of a game, to the point where we can say that the people who actually play the deepest and the most social part of a game, this is a player versus player matches, they're actually 10 times more valuable in terms of money for us than the people who just play the solo game. So social being 10 times more valuable than just the single player experience. Let's also take a look like what actually drives the monetization. So on the solo game, it's the usual suspects, but it actually gets really interesting when you look at like what people use money on the group missions, on the real-time cooperative multiplayer, and also on the player versus player. Because they're actually, There's, for example, an item called an airstrike, which is very, very popular among the people who play these group matches. And yes, the airstrike is a very effective, and it's also an expensive weapon. But we actually do not believe that the effectiveness of the weapon or that airstrike actually explains the success of it. Airstrike also happens to be the most visible weapon that you can have in the game, meaning that if I use an airstrike on something in a group mission, every other member will be sure to notice that. It sort of drives social value, and it's a way to sort of brag in the game if you use these types of items. And it's a great thing for us because then we can also price them higher. On the player versus player, you then have items which actually just help you win easier, as you might suspect. So that's how the game looks from a monetization perspective. And this brings us to our key learning number one. And it's as simple as that the real social gameplay is the key, and that really drives the value. And it actually turns out that for the people who are at the lower levels of a funnel, the friends that they made in-game are the primary reason to come back to the game. You could even say that these friends become more important than the game itself. So social is actually more important than the game experience as such, which is really interesting. And this is actually quite much in line what we kind of thought about. We couldn't summarize it like this, but we kind of had this idea that providing real social value will be also valuable for us, but we did not have any idea how valuable it could potentially be. But the next one was a complete surprise to us. And it's that the interest graph is much, much more important than the social graph. So just to be clear, so the social graph, we define it as your real friends on Facebook, so people who you most probably at least somehow know in real life because you've decided to accept them as your Facebook friends. Interest graph is the people who you share the same interest with. In this case, that would be that you are playing the Gunshine game. And I'll use a few slides to explain the concept and why it's actually turned out to be so important. Okay, so here's the starting point. On your left there, you have your sort of social graph, so and you're yourself, and that refers basically in this case your friends on Facebook. And then on the right, you have an interest graph, and in this case, that's people who are playing Gunshine. And you haven't discovered Gunshine yet, so these graphs are different. Then you do discover Gunshine, and then you actually become member of both graphs. It has proven to be extremely important in these types of games to actually provide what we call the signs of life for the user. So when you come to the game, you immediately see that also other people are playing the same game. So that's what's happening right here. Then hopefully you'll think that, hey, what a cool game. Let me invite some of my friends to the game as well. So you'll send a few invites. And if you're lucky, maybe one or two of your friends actually will decide to try the game out. And this is a key point. So this is the first time that your interest graph and the social graph actually overlap. And I'll come back a little bit later on why that's so crucially important. Okay, let's go on. So then hopefully you get addicted, so you keep on playing the game. But maybe, especially in the case of Gunshine, which is more of a core game, maybe your friends are not as core gamers as you are, and they'll play for a while, and then they just decide to quit and leave. And then again, they are back to square one. So your social graph and the interest graph are separate. Now we get to the key point. It's super important for the game to enable ways for the users to make friends also via the in-game. So at Supercell, for example, we intentionally built these type of areas which we call the hubs in Gunshine, where, for example, we will put all these sort of the guys who are give missions to these types of hubs, so that it's very natural for people to sort of bounce into each other and start to talk about something, and that's how they actually make friends. So okay, now you actually start to talk to other people and interact with others, so people who you didn't know previously. And if you're lucky, some of these guys may actually become your real friends. So not only friends in Gunshine, but maybe you decide to invite them, your friends, in Facebook again. And now we again get to the point where these two graphs overlap. So imagine what had happened had we not provided for the users an ability to make friends in game. That user would have stayed in the solo experience. So, and basically, it's very important from a monetization perspective. So if you remember the funnel that I just showed you, so the most important users are here in the bottom parts of the funnel. These are the most social users we have. And that wouldn't be possible unless it would be possible to actually friend people inside the game very, very easily, provide incentives to do so. And then also the holy grail kind of is that you kind of met somebody via game and then you also become Facebook friends. So then the relationship is all that much stronger. So that's very, very important. However, that also brings us to the biggest challenge that we've had and that we still have in the game. So in Gunshine, especially kind of forming these type of solid friendships, it actually requires, I would say, that almost too much from a user, especially if you think about that it's a very casual audience. So it actually requires a quite an intense real-time interaction, and that's obviously a problem for a casual user who don't want to plan their game sessions and don't want to sort of time them with other users, be them your real-life friends or your friends you've met via the game. So what's the final verdict then for the game? So clearly the positives there, but we were right on that the social value, it actually does improve the metrics and it definitely drives the monetization. We are also extremely happy with how the Facebook APIs worked out in terms of the games and how they enabled us to make the whole playing with friends and playing with other people experience better. It also helps us to form these tighter relationships as we can sort of bring in-game friends and try to provide ways for people to build these friendships also in your own social graph via the Facebook Friends API. Definitely it was the right choice to increase the bar in terms of production values. We got a lot of good buzz about it and users really appreciated it. And I guess most important, the lots of learnings, and obviously we built lots of technology that it's then completely reusable in the next products to come. Then the negatives, I think I've already mentioned a few of these. So clearly one of the learnings is that real-time cannot be and must not be a requirement, especially if you're targeting a more casual, or I would argue that even probably a mid-core audience. It's fair to ask the question that was the action RPG as a genre and the sort of theme, sort of a sci-fi theme, was that the right choice for the game or does it narrow the appeal too much? And definitely well, we just heard from a panel here from guys who sort of built essentially their business outside Facebook. These days, I would say that it's a much, much harder thing to do, as I think Heiko even said in his presentation. So to sort of sum it up, for us, Gunshine is it's a nicely profitable business, but definitely not the massive hit that we were hoping for. But definitely something that we could build on and what we will build on. So I'll just spend the next 3 or 4 minutes explaining what's the kind of next step for us the company, and what we kind of took from here. So first of all, of course, we want to take with us everything, all the positives that we learned from Gunshine. So first and foremost, we're going to take the very rich social gameplay that we built in there, but we're probably going to shape it a little bit more on an asynchronous manner so that it isn't as intense on the sort of your time requirements. We're going to put even more and heavier focus on trying to build this sort of interest graph as opposed to the social graph. Of course, we're going to keep the high production values. We are still huge believers in Facebook and how Facebook APIs will help us to create new types of social gameplay experiences. So we'll definitely keep that. And then, of course, we'll keep the technology that we just built. However, we're going to also do some changes to the mix. First and foremost, we've decided to shift the platform focus to sort of tablet and mobile platforms. We believe that there's a there's a larger variety of games that, that consumers play on these platforms, and sort of the type of games that we want to do. It's probably a better platform from that perspective. It also actually helps us to focus the company and our efforts a little bit, and therefore probably results in a higher quality products. Also, we were going to widen and broaden the theme. So whereas Gunshine was based on this kind of like dark dystopian future, so sci-fi type of theme, you'll see in some of the examples that follow that we're definitely going to go for a little bit more cartoony and hopefully a little bit more wider appeal or theme appeal with the next products. We are actually going to launch a number of products based on the technology platform that we developed actually originally for Gunshine, but we can easily leverage for these new products on mobile and tablet platforms as well. So there's five new games going out in Q2. I'm going to give you guys one example because it's a good example of the things that we really want to do. So the game is called Battle Buddies. It's probably going to go out in April. And I'm going to show a very quick development video of the game. So as you can hear from the background sounds, it's a live footage from our office. This is actually a part of a series of videos that we've started to post on the Facebook page of Battle Buddies. It already has, I think, more than 11,000 likes and fans following it. Basically, what you have here is a sort of a line-drawing tactical combat game. So the first thing that we did and what we're all about is that we thought that we want to really like rethink how these types of games are created for this type of platform. So we didn't even consider doing a sort of virtual joystick type of control. We really wanted to make it true to the platform, and we think drawing is a good solution. As opposed to Gunshine, this game will package multiplayer as sort of digital snacks as opposed to being a really intense sort of real-time experience. But we will definitely keep the rich social interaction. So this game is all about playing with other people, and especially against other people in live tournaments. So the idea is that I have a group of five people who I can guide and draw, and then I'll actually submit my move to my opponent, and then that opponent will get notified on his or her tablet or mobile phone, and then they'll do their move, and then I'll get the move back, and so forth. So it isn't really as intense and sort of time intense as, for example, the gameplay on Gunshine was. It's actually very close to sort of playing, say, chess via mail, for example. And we definitely believe it's a fairly unique combination of casual and core. If you're curious to kind of follow the progress, go like this Facebook page. We are now in this habit of posting development videos like that one on a weekly basis. So we really wanted to like keep this open development approach and give the opportunity to our users and fans to follow what we are up to. But that's kind of like where the strategy has evolved from so Supercell. So if you think about like from this like really like core real-time, very deep MMO type of a game, we wanted to kind of take what was like really great about it, and then package it a little bit differently, and hopefully with a better fit to the casual audience. And as I said, we are busy and hard at work for more games like that. So Q2 is going to be a big quarter for us. So hopefully, getting five high-quality games out for the tablet and mobile platforms. So stay tuned. Thanks very much. That's all I had.
Hello. There we go. We have a couple. We have probably time for one question. I had a really quick question, which was, you work in the loudest game software development office I've ever heard. It's like a machine shop. What's going on in the background? You work in a factory?
Yeah, you know, it's just all the fans keep calling us every day. You know, so. They're so eager to play the game.
So we had a couple questions. Oh, you have a microphone already. God, I just can't get ahead of her.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Hi, Ilkka. What sort of marketing plans do you have when you launch these games, and which kind of budget, if you can share with us? now on Android and iOS?
Well, first of all, we think that it all starts with like creating the buzz and really working together with your users. So the one thing that I actually didn't mention, but I think we got absolutely right with Gunshine, is that we actually started to talk about the game very, very early on. And we were extremely open about like what's going in the game with our community. And that's we have exact same approach that we took with Battle Buddies. So I think the Facebook page went live several months ago, and the game is only about to fully launch in the US in April. So the idea is that they sort of kind of co-develop a game with a user. So that's the starting point. But then of course it's all the usual things. So of course you want to get the platform holders to get excited about the game. So needless to say, for example, if you can get Apple to feature your game, that will be a big part of the success. But you know, we've also seen examples and actually quite close to home about companies who just, you know, put a great game out and all of a sudden it's the biggest brand in the world, or at least quickest growing brand in the world, even if it's about, you know, pigs and Angry Birds. So I think also the quality of the game is kind of a, in the end, that's your best marketing tool. But yes, I mean, let's face it, you still need a marketing budget of, I would say, like several hundreds of thousands of dollars in the minimum to kind of start to build the critical mass for the game, especially in games which require a sort of a multi, or which are about multiplayer. So it's not fun to play that game alone. But I think the one thing that we did learn from Gunshine is how to kind of fairly cleverly use the Facebook APIs, not for spamming people, but actually trying to provide real value for the users if they actually get other people to play the game with them. And then actually that creates, I think, the right kind of virality for the game.
Hi. I'm over here. I have a question. You mentioned about the numbers, 300,000 users, and you, in the design of the game, you said you wanted it sort of platform agnostic in a sense. You could play it on Facebook, or you could play it directly on the site. And also you wanted that from a perspective of registration, so you could be Facebook registered, or you could be create your own social graph within presumably your own database. How did that difference between Facebook and non-Facebook, both in the registration and the platform play, end up in the figures?
That's a great question. We've actually like, and the really interesting part about that is that it has evolved over time. So the first users that we got in, like when they actually, even during the closed beta, they're like extremely active and actually really well monetizing users. And those users came actually outside the Facebook. So clearly there was this set of like hardcore users who didn't want to play the game on Facebook, but would rather just play it on its own destination site, kind of like on their own and within the game community, and they didn't care about the Facebook community at all. But surprisingly, I think that has changed and evolved over like over months. So as the time has gone by, like more and more, the Facebook gamer has been getting closer to the gamer or the user who's like playing the kind of a non-Facebook canvas version. So right now, there actually isn't a huge difference in those two user profiles.
We've got one more question. You say the game was profitable. Can we know how much it costed to develop and how much you earn each month?
Well, I probably won't go quite that far in the transparency.
And the names of all your most talented employees.
Yeah, but clearly the game is profitable. So we are making a lot more money than what we're spending on advertising. So I mean, and you know, we are spending on advertising on that type of a game. But don't think I'll be sharing exact figures.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.